فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحومك الطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Complete blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all and bless every one of us. My brothers and sisters, indeed, the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the greatest. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has addressed this in the Quran. And I'd like to start off this afternoon's talk here in Zamboanga, in this beautiful country of the Philippines, with a recitation of the Quran, which has in it these verses from Surah Al-Ahzab.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا ولما رأى المؤمنون الأحزاب قالوا هذا ما وعدنا الله ورسوله وصدق الله ورسوله وما زادهم إلا إيمانا وتسليما من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا ليجزي الله الصادقين بصدقهم ويعذب المنافقين إن شاء أو يتوب عليهم إن الله كان غفورا رحيما.
In another verse, a few verses later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says,
Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashshiran wa nadhira وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا وبشر المؤمنين بأن لهم من الله فضلا كبيرا.
In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying,
وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ.
Subhanallah. Subhanallah. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my maker and yours, my brothers, my sisters.
لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ.
Indeed, Allah has favored the believers. Allah has given a gift to the believers when He sent a messenger to them from amongst them.
يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ.
This messenger reciting the verses and the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to them, and at the same time, purifying them, teaching them the best in terms of purification of worship, worshipping Allah alone, and in terms of character and conduct, in terms of your treatment to other human beings and other creatures of Allah, that too upon the purest level, and reciting to you the verses of the book, as well as that which came before, to confirm everything that came before, that was the gift of Allah upon us. He sent us Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, my brothers, my sisters, today as you are seated here, you need to realize the biggest gift that you have is you are worshipping Allah alone. Remember that. Don't allow contamination of worship. What that means is you are not worshipping a human being, you are not worshipping a stick or a stone, you are not worshipping an idol or a grave, you are not worshipping a creature of Allah or the creature of the Creator, but you are only worshipping the Creator who made you. Him alone we worship, Him alone we ask for help. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You alone, you alone we worship, O Allah. And you alone we shall seek the help of. May Allah help us. May He make us from those who worship Him alone. But remember, let others do what they want. Subhanallah. Let others do what they want. Allah created human beings, Allah created other creatures, and Allah created the plants as well. So you look at the creatures of Allah, there is a plan of Allah. Don't think that you will disturb that plan. No, it is the plan of Allah. Some people will be rightly guided, some people will not be rightly guided, but everyone will think that they are the ones who are rightly guided. كُلُّ حِزْبٍ بِمَا لَدَيْهِمْ فَرِحُونَ. Every group is happy with what they are following, with what they think is right. What do I need to do? I need to constantly question myself. I need to ask myself, is what I am doing, what was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is what I am doing the requirement of my maker? Is what I am doing correct? You need to constantly ask yourself until you find evidence that you are satisfied with, that proves to you indeed what you are doing is correct. Don't be shy or ashamed to correct yourself, to change yourself when you are going wrong. Don't be ashamed to actually admit that what I'm doing is wrong. Let me now do what is right, because you have the chance for as long as you're alive. My brothers and sisters, if you're alive, you have a chance. If you're doing something wrong, cut it, quit it, stop it, and change. When? Now. Not later on, oh, tomorrow morning I'm going to start a new leaf. No, by that time it's already watered down. Now, if there is something you are doing wrong, right now you say, oh Allah, I did this for many years, it was wrong, I regret it, I admit my sin, I ask you to forgive me, not going to do it again, from now. If you have not been dressing appropriately, for example, or if you have been sitting on your phone with the wrong people, for example, or if you are watching that which is dirty and wrong, or if you are gambling or drinking, or if you are on drugs, no matter what drug it is, promise Allah now that you will quit. I'm talking of the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did I start this way? Because my brothers and sisters, we are his followers. How can we call ourselves his followers when we are not interested in following what exactly he has brought? Subhanallah. What legacy are you going to talk about when we are not even interested in following? Why should I speak about the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when you and I are not even following that particular example, my brothers and sisters? Do you see what I'm saying? We say we love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we don't follow him. If your boyfriend or girlfriend who is haram for you to have a relationship with tells you to do something silly, you will do it because you want to impress them, you want to make them happy. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us, never mind about loving some human or loving someone, what about your love for Allah? If you want to prove it, look what Allah says.
قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم.
O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them if they love Allah, then follow me. Meaning follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah will love them and forgive their sins, for indeed He is most forgiving, most merciful. Amazing. You love Allah? Follow the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Life is too short to spend it in the disobedience of Allah. Disobedience, my brothers and sisters, does not bring about joy except very temporary. Ask those who commit adultery. Do they get joy for more than a few minutes? After that, it is regret and stress. Ask those who are addicted to the bottle. How much joy do they get? A few moments perhaps. They think that they don't have problems, not realizing that we forgot the problems temporarily only. And when we became sober, they were bigger problems than they were before we actually became intoxicated. Ask those on drugs, they will tell you the same thing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. My brothers, my sisters, sin does not bring about true happiness. Obedience brings about true happiness. Calmness, contentment, long-term solutions, not short-term patch. You know what is patchwork? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. So this is why I decided to start this way, to make me realize and to make every one of us realize that the biggest gift we have is the fact that we are worshippers of Allah, followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So who was he? What did he leave behind? How did he deal with matters that arose? Number one, from the very beginning he was known as As-Sadiq Al-Ameen. As-Sadiq Al-Ameen. Don't be shy to say this. He was known as As-Sadiq Al-Ameen. He was known as the truthful, the trustworthy. From when? From a young age. Very young age. My brothers and sisters, do you know what it takes to be known as a truthful, trustworthy person today? And we claim to be billions of followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In a whole city, maybe you can count a few people who are truthful and trustworthy. Am I right? Where is the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Look at him. He was truthful, trustworthy. Fight yourself to become truthful and trustworthy. Fight yourself, for indeed, if that is the case, you will be honoring the fact that you are following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You claim something with your mouth. You should believe it in your heart. And you should work towards it with your organs. That's something. That is Iman. I believe in Allah. I said it with my tongue. But I need to have it in my heart and I need to work towards it. I cannot lead a life in such a way that I say something but I do something else. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu lima taquluna ma la taf'alun. O you who believe, why do you say that which you do not do? Subhanallah. Don't be a hypocrite. Be honest, be genuine, be sincere. Learn the truth, follow it. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, known as trustworthy and honest from an early age. Before that, he was an orphan. Subhanallah. You and I know that he is known as Afdalul Khalqi wa Akramul Rusuli, the best of creation, the most noble of all messengers of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah chose for him to have no father who was alive upon his birth. Meaning his father passed away prior to his birth. This is an honor and a consolation for all those who are orphans. Ana wa kafilu al-yatimi ka hatayni fil jannah. Myself and the one who takes care of an orphan shall be like these two fingers in paradise. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because himself, he was an orphan. He was looked after by his grandfather when he passed away, by his uncle, and so on. A little while later, he lost his mother at the age of 6. Tender, very tender. So when you have lost your parents or lost one of them, my brothers, my sisters, let us train our children from an early age that in fact does not mean you are disadvantaged in any way. Rather, it is somehow a sign of the love of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And be careful the way you treat the orphans.
فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر.
As for the orphan child, do not be harsh, do not be hard on that particular child. Be lenient, be calm, be soft. Reach out to them, look after them, train them, guide them in the most beautiful way. And as for the one who is asking you something, don't rebuke the person. When someone is begging from you, you do not have to give them. If you want, you can give them. If you feel for some reason something is wrong with this, like a few days ago someone asked me something when I was at a traffic light back at home. And they had like a milk packet, and in the milk packet they had something inside, a glue substance, and they were sniffing this glue. So back at home where I come from, it's a type of a drug. They hallucinate, they become high on what? On glue. Sorry, I'm not teaching you what to do, but I'm only telling you this is what happens, okay? So this guy was actually sort of inhaling this glue, and he's asking me for money. I looked at him, I smiled, and I did this. I pointed at his packet and I said no, and I carried on. I did not rebuke him because I thought of the verse that, you know what, the man is asking, you don't have to rebuke. You don't want to give, don't give. Be respectful and go away. Subhanallah. I gave a message and I went away. I'm not saying I'm ideal, but I was reminded by the verse of the Quran what to do. Had I done from my own heart and my soul, I would have probably shouted, scolded and said something that would be hurtful and go away regretting. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So this was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he grew older. When he came, he spoke the truth. He spoke the truth in a very polite way. Some people think he spread Islam in a harsh way. No. From the very beginning, he went to his people, "Oh my people, say La ilaha illallah, you will enter Jannah." According to the narrations, the people used to make circumambulation or tawaf of the Kaaba, the house of Allah in Mecca. They used to circumambulate naked. Naked. They used to remove their clothing and then they used to circumambulate. Now that is worse than the miniskirts we have today. Do you agree? It's worse. What happened? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to look down. And he was there looking down saying, "Ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. Ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. Ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. O people, say la ilaha illallah, you will be successful. O people, say la ilaha illallah, you will be successful. O people, bear witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah, and you will be successful." He kept on repeating this, and guess what? It affected some of them, not all of them. At that stage it affected and helped some of them. So he kept on speaking the truth, but in a polite way. When they harmed him, he did not harm them back, no. Look at Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Radiyallahu anhu. When did he become a Muslim? When he returned one day from a hunting trip. And as he was going towards the masjid, he was told that Abu Jahl has beaten your nephew. And Abu Jahl had taken some object and tried to harm Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This uncle heard about it. He came back and he beat Abu Jahl with a bow, and he told him, "Atashtumuhu wa ana ala dinihi aqulu ma yaqul." How can you rebuke or swear this man when I am following what he is saying? That was the declaration of Islam. Of who? Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. One of the powerful men. He was known as the lion. Asadullah. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us strength. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you and I know, when he was in Ta'if and he was faced with attack, what did he do? He prayed for his people. How many of us, when we see the enemies of Islam who harm Islam, do we pray for them? Oh Allah, guide them to Islam. Oh Allah, soften their hearts. Oh Allah, bring them forth. Oh Allah, the bad that they are doing, the energy that they are using to do bad, convert it so that they can use it to do good. That was the dua of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu. And it worked. It came. He came a little while later and he declared his shahada. Subhanallah. Amazing. Look at Abu Talib. There is another powerful example in the life of Abu Talib. He was the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He supported Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he was not a Muslim. Right at the end, when he was on his deathbed, and he had done so much of good work that no one could dare mention Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name negatively in his presence. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to him and said, Ya Ammi, qul kalimatan uhajju laka biha yawm al-qiyamah. Oh my uncle, you are on your deathbed. Say one sentence and I will fight your case on the day of judgment. What was the sentence? La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. He did not say it. Why? Allah says,
إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ.
You do not guide whomsoever you wish. Allah guides whomsoever He wishes. In another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
مَا عَلَى الرَّسُولِ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ.
The duty of the messenger is nothing besides to convey the message clearly. That was the duty. You conveyed it, move on. Allah will deal with this person. They will either be brought forward or the evidence will be placed against them. In Arabic we say, إِقَامَةُ الْحُجَّ عَلَيْهِ. The Arabic language, the meaning of it is, the evidence has now been placed squarely in their court. They are answerable to Allah. They got the message. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was assisted in spreading Islam by a non-Muslim who was related to him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيُؤَيِّدُ هَذَا الدِّينِ بِالرَّجُلِ الْفَاجِرِ. The hadith says, Allah can use a sinful person to support the deen. Sometimes a person who's not a Muslim, they can give some form of relief or comfort by the will of Allah to a person who's a Muslim. Subhanallah. Now if we take a look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam later on, yes, there were battles, the battle of Badr, the battle of Uhud, the battles, these battles, legitimate battles by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's instruction to get back what was taken from them when they were driven out of Makkah al-Mukarramah. Their land was taken, their wealth was taken, usurped, they were driven out of their homes. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you cannot make friends with those people who drove you out of your homes and they fought you, they stole all your belongings. You want to make friends with them? Subhanallah. You see, today there are people who use the verses of the Quran and they use these verses, they say, you are not allowed to have friends from among the Christians and the Jews because Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَىٰ أَوْلِيَاءَ. O you who believe, do not take the Jews and the Christians as your friends. So they translate it as friends, yet the term awliya does not mean friends. It is talking of protectors at time of war, and the interpretation of it is in the next verse. لا تَتَّخِذُوا الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا دِينَكُمْ هُزُوًا وَلَعِبًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَالْكُفَّارَ أَوْلِيَاءَ. There is something called tafsir. Tafsir means the explanation of the verse of the Quran. The most powerful method of tafsir is tafsirul Qur'ani bil Qur'an. To explain the Quran where it is in brief by another verse where it is in detail. So a few verses later, Allah explains who are the disbelievers He is talking about. He's talking about those who mock and scoff at you, those who jeer, those who drove you out of your homes, those who killed you. Subhanallah, you have people who are fighting you and you want to befriend those who have driven you out of your homes. The kuffar of Mecca, it was wrong for the people to befriend them. There was an incident, and more than one, where some of the relatives had sent messages to their own relatives who were in Mecca, who were part of those who drove the Muslims away, telling them some details about the Muslim plans, and Allah exposed them. And Allah says, no. Look at Surah Al-Mumtahina, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إنما ينهاكم الله عن الذين قاتلوكم في الدين وأخرجوكم من دياركم وظاهروا على إخراجكم أن تَوَلَّوْهُمْ.
The term tawallawhum is used, wilaya, awliya, the same root word. Allah says, do you want to know who are the people from the disbelievers whom we don't want you to befriend? Do you want to know who from the disbelievers are those whom we don't want you to befriend? They are the ones whom, qatalukum fi ddin, they fought you regarding your deen. Wa akhrajukum min diyarikum, they drove you out of your homes. وَظَاهَرُوا عَلَىٰ إِخْرَاجِكُمْ, or they helped and assisted to drive you out of your homes. Allah says, how can you befriend them? And how can, not only friendship, the term wilaya is higher than friendship. It goes to protection where you have a treaty with them, you have an agreement with them. Subhanallah. But then Allah says, لَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُوكُمْ. It's a beautiful verse. Allah says in Surah Al-Mumtahina, Allah says, Allah does not prohibit you from befriending those from among the disbelievers, or being just with them, upright with them. Those from among the disbelievers who did not fight you. There are innocent people around. They are disbelievers. You all were disbelievers at some stage. Someone worked on you. Someone worked on your forefathers. That's why you are Muslims today, myself included. Why am I saying this? Because people are using verses of the Quran to confuse the Muslim public, to say you cannot befriend the Christian who is innocent, your neighbor. My brother, my sister, you can marry a person of the book under certain conditions. So I'm going to marry you, you're a Christian lady, but you know what? I'm not your friend. Subhanallah, where is your brain? I'm going to have children with you. I'm going to marry you. But you know what? I can't be your friend. How? The last verses of the Quran were the verses of the marriage to al-kitabiyya, meaning a Jewish woman or a Christian woman. You can marry them. Subhanallah. It is in the Quran. Yes, there are certain conditions, but you can ultimately, that nikah would be valid. You cannot argue with that. No one can. Like I said, there are conditions, rules, regulations. You fulfill them and it happens. How can that be the case if Allah says, you're not allowed to be friends? Brother, forget about friendship. I'm allowed to marry and have children. You follow what I say? This is in Surah Al-Ma'idah. So my brothers and sisters, remember one thing. When you are a religious person close to Allah, does it make you hard or soft? Tell me. Say it loudly. It makes you soft. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. It is only by the mercy of Allah that you are lenient, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, towards them. What is leniency? It is the softness of the nature. You are soft in nature towards them. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَظًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were hard, harsh, hard-hearted, they would never want to listen to you. They would disperse. They would run away. Today you are seated here. Why? Why? Why are you here today? You want to listen to a message that will soften you, right? You want to listen to a message that will bring you closer to Allah. You want to listen to a message that will remind you of goodness. You don't want to come here and listen to me attacking this one and that one, or listen to me being hard and harsh and dooming all of you, my brothers, my sisters. You are already in the fire. Is that what you want me to say? If you're already in the fire, well, I'm in the same place as you. What would happen to me? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. We are here to listen to a beautiful message. I started off reading the most beautiful words of Allah. And I want to give you a message of peace and goodness, because a sign of closeness to Allah is that you are soft. Your nature is good. You love the creatures of Allah. Who made other human beings? Who made the kuffar? Who made everyone else? Who made the dogs and the pigs? The same Allah who made you. You have to admit. You have to admit. You see a pig out there, for example. You and I know we are not allowed to eat a pig, right? We cannot associate more, even sometimes with certain animals, right? We cannot. Because that's the ruling that we have in our religion. But Can you just go and say, right, pick, start throwing stones? Can you do that? No. There is life in that animal. You cannot throw stones at a pig just like that because it is a pig. The pig was created by Allah. You're not allowed to consume it or deal with it, etc., etc. But to harm it just like that, wallahi, you will pay a heavy price. Heavy price. You know a dog, my brothers and sisters, a dog? In Islam, we have rules and regulations governing our relationship with a dog. What we can and cannot do. When you can and cannot have a dog, for example, very strict rulings. If a dog was to lick you, what would happen? طهور إناء أحدكم إذا ولغ فيه الكلب أن يغسله سبع مرات أولاهن بالتراب. According to one narration, the utensils that have been licked by a dog need to be washed 7 times with water. The first one, perhaps with a little bit of what we would term detergent, sand or dust. Subhanallah. With those rulings, there was a man, and I'm not going to get deeply into the story because I repeat the story every time. There was a man, sahih narration, authentic narration, a man who quenched the thirst of a dog. When he came up from the well and he saw the dog and he felt, this dog is thirsty, let me quench the thirst of the dog. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we loved that action so much, we gave him forgiveness. Imagine, a man earning Jannah because he looked at a dog and he decided to quench the thirst of a dog. The question I have, who is more high in status, a dog or a human being? If to quench the thirst of a dog got you forgiveness, what do you think you will achieve by quenching the thirst of a human being? Someone who does not share your faith, they don't share it, but they're a human being. We have disasters in a lot of countries at the moment that supposedly are natural. When I say natural, I mean sometimes you have a tsunami, sometimes you have typhoons, sometimes you have hurricanes, whatever else. We could have earthquakes and so on. We have floods in some areas. Trust me, as a human being, you have to do everything in your capacity to save lives. To save lives. That's your test. When someone sees you drowning, they could be anything. Their humanity will lead them to try and save you. They will not say, ah, that one has a beard, leave him, let him drown. This one wearing scarf, let her go. You cannot say that. They will save you. You will save them too. You cannot say, hey, you declare shahada? Ah, okay, drown. You cannot say that. You save them. وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Whoever saves one life is equivalent to the one who saved humanity at large. One life. Allah didn't say, مَنْ أَحْيَا مُسْلِمًا. مَنْ أَحْيَا هَا النَّفْسِ. Whoever saves a life, one life, any life, that person will come out, their life will change for the sake of Allah. They will see you, you save them, you jump straight in. Someone asked me once, if you see a gay drowning, would you save? I said, I would be the first one to jump in, save them, what's wrong? Subhanallah, they are human, that is life. You get a reward from Allah. When you see an animal drowning, you save the animal. Subhanallah. Sometimes we love our kittens more than we love other human beings. I promise you, I get so many questions every week. Sheikh, will my cat be in Jannah with me? My cat? Will my cat be in Jannah with me? If it's not going to be in Jannah, I don't want to go there. What? Subhanallah, my beloved child, work so hard that you go to Jannah first. When you go there, Allah says, فيها ما تشتهيه الأنفس وتلذ الأعين وأنتم فيها خالدون. In it, whatever is sweet to your eyes, you will have it. Whatever your heart desires, you will have it. In where? In Jannah. And you will be there forever. So, when you get there, then you can decide what you want and what you don't.
there might be something way better than your cat. You might never think of your cat again. Subhanallah. What type of betrayal is that? I can give you another quick example. Some people, they say, you know, I can't afford to this car, but inshallah when I go to Jannah, I will get it. I say, no, relax. The people in 1910, if they made the same dua, they would only get those old Victorian cars which had bicycle tires on them, four of them, which were starting when you had to crank the front of the engine. I don't know if you know those old cars. For them, that was their Jannah. So don't make a dua for Jannah related to something in your times. Because before even the day of Qiyamah, you will never want that same thing again. Imagine those who lived in 1960. Ya Allah, I can't afford this Mercedes. When I go to Jannah, give me two of them. Now you have two by 1960 Mercedes. You don't even want them today. Leave them. Subhanallah. You follow what I'm saying? So don't make a dua relative to your time with a material item. Say, oh Allah, give me paradise. And you need to be convinced when you have paradise, you will get what you want there. Subhanallah. Allah promised you. Sometimes people say, when I go to Jannah, will I have the same husband? Guess what? The true answer to it is Allah will make you happy. Don't worry. You will never ever regret. Allah will make you so happy that you will be shocked as to the level of happiness, contentment, joy and excitement that you will have within you. May Allah give us Jannatul Firdaus. Say Ameen. To get to Jannah, follow the true footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Listen, my brothers and sisters, when you read five daily prayers, a sign of acceptance is it softens your heart. If it makes your heart hard, there is something wrong with your salah. When you dress properly, it should soften your heart. If your heart becomes hard, something wrong with your dress. Your intention is wrong. Your sincerity is wrong. You have pride. You have arrogance. What is pride in Islam? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ مَنْ كَانَ فِي قَلْبِهِ مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِنْ خَرْدَلٍ مِنْ كِبْرٍ. He will never enter paradise in whose heart is a mustard seed's weight worth of pride. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the companions, they were surprised. They asked, oh messenger, we like our clothing, we like our conveyance to be nice and neat. He said, that is not pride. We all like good clothing. Look, see here. Can you see this? I made sure it was done before I came. Why? That's us. We want to look decent. We want to look reasonable. My brother Wasim is laughing there. Subhanallah. Yes, we want to look smart. Mashallah. But that's not pride. Pride shows in your attitude. I can drive into Zamboanga with a Ferrari. Yes, I can. But guess what? If I'm humble, I still go to the masjid, I still greet the people, I still talk nicely, I'm still a person who is reachable, etc., etc., within limits, then I'm still a good guy. The Prophet ﷺ says, pride is not connected to your clothing or your housing. No, it's connected to your attitude. بَطُرُ الْحَقِّ وَغَمْطُ النَّاسِ. When you reject the truth, you are arrogant. When you despise people, you are proud. You think you are big, others are small. You have pride. Sometimes when we read five salah, we think we are big and everyone else is going to Jahannam. Subhanallah. You know, the last time I sat with one young guy. He was from the nightclub. Listen carefully. He was from the nightclubs and Allah guided him. He came to the masjid. But he came with a bang. Because sometimes when you sow misguidance in your life and then you come to guidance, you become very hard. Brother, you saw the light after 25 years. Why do you want these people to see the light in 25 minutes? Where are you? Where's your brain gone? Subhanallah. They will also take time. You keep on trying until you die. They may or may not see the light. You will get a reward for trying. Don't harm them. Don't attack them. Don't kill them. Don't think that is Islam. That is not Islam. Islam is to keep trying, and I will keep conveying the message because they belong to Allah just like I belong to Allah. Allah made them as sophisticated as He made me. They have a brain and eyes, a tongue and nose, etc. just like I do. What gives me the right to take life away? I'm not allowed to do that. So from the nightclub to the masjid, and what happened thereafter? So hard. He was telling me, brother, don't you see these people are doing shirk? They are going to Jahannam. That one's Jahannam. I said, brother, you don't know upon what condition they may die. So keep trying with them until the day you die. He said, you are far from the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I said, brother, just because I'm telling you what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, you don't know, do you read the Quran? He says, yes, I read. I said, okay, read for me. I opened for him Mus'haf, you know, the Quran. He said, no, I don't read Arabic. You are the sheikh of all the mashayikh, giving the big fatwas to kill this one and to harm that one. You cannot read the Quran. Surah Al-Fatiha. You don't even know how to recite it. And wallahi, this happens with 99% of those who promote killing. They don't know how to read Quran. They can't. They cannot translate it for you. Why? Because their message is not from the Quran. It's a confusion that was created from other people similar. Be careful of this. You listen to the words of Allah, understand them. When you don't understand something, ask someone and keep asking someone. There is a beautiful explanation. Remember how Islam came to this part of the world. It came through the character and the conduct of the people. It never came through fighting and killing people. Every time there was fighting and killing in this part of the world, there was a disaster. It resulted in destruction. Islam, the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is to build, not to destroy. To make peace, not to make war. Remember that. Subhanallah. That is the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at how they've destroyed the homes, the houses, the infrastructure, the cities. Taken them 150 years back in the name of Islam. Allahu Akbar. Is that what the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is? Go to the countries where the Muslims were, you will see what they have built up to today. It exists. Why in our own places do we need to destroy brother, fighting brother? For what? That is not the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He didn't do that. لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس. There is no goodness. There is no goodness in the secret meetings that the people hold unless within them there is instruction or discussion of how to promote goodness, charity, and solving the problems between the people. We are discussing how to bring people together. We don't want to divide ourselves. Today, among the Muslims, we are looking for reasons to split ourselves. Brother, you read Salah this way, I have two differences with you. You belong to something else, you are going to Jahannam. And according to that one, I am going to Jahannam. And according to another one, both of us are going to Jahannam. And according to a fourth one, all three of us are going to Jahannam. And we are all kuffar. Why? Subhanallah. So then who is going to Jannah? Explain. Do you understand my question? Everyone seems to be going to Jahannam. What's going to happen, Jannah? It's going to be empty, empty property. Subhanallah. No. No way. Inshallah, we will all be in Jannatul Firdaus. It is so wide, so broad. It will bring you in there, myself in there, all of us in there, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His mercy. Keep trying and keep trying with hope in the mercy of Allah. You will be in paradise. Don't lose hope. Don't let shaitan come to you and make you think, no, I can't get it. You can. I was reading a message today. An old man asked another. Sorry, a young man asked an old man. He says, who is going to take account on the day of judgment? The old man says, Allah. He says, in that case, I'm not too worried. Allah is merciful. We will go to Jannah. If it was someone else, maybe we need to worry. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the day of judgment. وَخَشَعَتِ الْأَصْوَاتُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ فَلَا تَسْمَعُ إِلَّا هَمْسًا. On that day, you won't even hear a whisper. All the voices will be silenced. For who? He didn't say for Allah. He didn't use the name Allah. Allah uses the name Lirrahman. Have you thought of that? Allah says, everyone will be silenced. For Ar-Rahman, for the most merciful. If he wanted, he could say for the most powerful. For the strongest. For the creator. For the one who will punish. No, he says for the most merciful. So the young boy is saying, if Allah says on the day of judgment that He is the most merciful, why should we worry? What that means is, We don't go and commit sin and say, oh Allah, you are Ghafoorul Rahim. I know you are Ghafoorul Rahim. I will drink, I will do this. You will forgive me. No, you are insulting Allah. You try your best and then leave the rest in the hands of Allah. You follow what I'm saying? Okay. Then another one. We call out to Allah, a lot of us, and we don't realize, we keep saying, Allah did not answer my dua. Am I right? We keep saying, I'm asking Allah, Allah did not answer my dua. But my brothers and sisters, today, right here, right now, think about duas that you made 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 30 years ago. You already have that and more than that. You are living inside the positive response of your previous dua, but you are still complaining to Allah about new duas that you have made. Oh Allah, you didn't reply me. When we are young, oh Allah, help me, help me. You were helped, oh Allah, give me success. You got success, oh Allah, job, you got the job. Oh Allah, marriage, you are married. Oh Allah, children, you are children. May Allah grant those who don't have spouses, good spouses. Say Ameen. May Allah grant those who don't have children, children. May Allah give those who have children, good children. But we make the dua. Today we have. Each time Allah gives you something, you forget and you go to a new dua. And then you say, Allah is not answering me. Hang on. You made 10,000 dua in your life. 9,500 we gave you. 500 maybe we changed it a little bit for you. We knew it was not good for you. Now what? Subhanallah. So one man says to another, he asks him a question. He says, do you know such and such a person whose du'as are all accepted? Du'a, by the way, is supplication. Do you know such and such a person whose supplications are all accepted? He says, no, but I know the one who accepts the supplications. You follow? It's not important to know who is mustajabu da'wah. Mustajabu da'wah means some people, they have a gift. Every time they make a du'a, it's given. That is called mustajabu da'wah. They are maybe pious, maybe close to Allah. So Allah gave them. But it's more important to know alladhi yastajib ad-du'a, the one who answers the supplication. Make a relationship with him. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. Develop your relation with Allah. So getting back to the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me explain something beautiful to you. Beautiful. You see, when you become close to Allah, you become concerned about the people. And you become softened. And you become lenient. Because these are characteristics of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was very lenient. He was loving. He was kind. If you want to know that you are pious, it will show in the way you treat your wife. First. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, khayrukum. خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best from amongst you are those who are best to their wives, to their children. So if you are reading 5 salah a day, but you come home and you are angry, upset, something wrong with your salah. You are just paying lip service to that salah. Go and correct it. Humble yourself to Allah. It will make you love the rest of the people that Allah has blessed you with. Your family members, how do you talk to them? Wallahi, we have no relationship. We speak in a harsh tone. We come home like we are jabbarin, like we want to kill someone. Why? Subhanallah. Some people, when they are about to get married, the young boys, their friends teach them, hey, make sure she doesn't sit on your head. Watch out, when you talk to her, you must be hard. Otherwise, she's going to think you are soft. She will sit on your head. So the brother says, what should I do? He says, every time you scream, you know, talk now. No. Calm down. Follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What you were told is not prophetic. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated his family members with the best of respect, utmost love, greatest romance, subhanallah, the most beautiful relationship. That's what he was. What about you? Following? No. We're not following. Well, then make an effort to follow. Subhanallah. How do you treat other human beings? I want to tell you something, my brothers, my sisters. All of us think we are good people, right? Who thinks that they are bad people? Put up your hand. If you're a really bad person, put up your hand. No one. No one. Subhanallah. We all think we are good. Inshallah, we are good. Ameen. Do you want to know how good your character is? Can I give you one test? question, you answer it, and you will know who you are. It's like a litmus test. You know, litmus test, you put in the litmus paper to test that chemical, and you take it out. If the color changes, yes. If it doesn't, well, that's not right. Listen to the question. On earth, the people of the earth that the world considers the lowest of the low, the most insignificant, the ones whom, subhanallah, they will not benefit you in any way according to the world. The world looks at the person as low. Either they work for you, either they clean the streets, they clean the toilet. Someone very, very low according to the world. How do you treat that person determines who you are. When you see someone cleaning the streets, when you see someone the world does not look at, do you look at them? Do you acknowledge them? It could have been you. It could have been your family members. It could be anyone. They are a human. They have family. They also love. They also have likes and dislikes. They also want to eat and drink just like you. But Allah has put them, according to the worldly standing, slightly lower than you. How do you treat them determines who you are. Your level of character is determined by how you treat those who are way below you. Remember that. Not those who are equal and not those who are higher. Sometimes when they are higher, when they are equal, you know what? There might be another reason that you are helping. You see a very pretty lady and she falls down. Ooh, 20 men will go and try to pick her up. Why? She was a pretty girl. That's why. What did we go for? We went because she was pretty. How do I know that? Because at the same time, there was an old lady who broke her leg 1 meter away. You didn't even notice. You didn't even notice. Why? She was old. It's a fact. Go back to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life. He taught you that even if it was a dog, you were supposed to go and help. Allahu Akbar. Why did that hadith I mentioned speak about a dog? Because there is no question about the ikhlas and the sincerity of that man's deed. If it was a pretty woman who was thirsty, they would have brought her the freshest of juice. They would have flown to another country to bring the juice. Say, please drink. Yes. But Allah says, no, it was not a female, it was not a human, it was not even a peacock. You know why? The peacock might open its feathers to make you happy. Say, ooh, let me give this peacock a bit of water. It looks so sweet. No, it's a dog. Allahu Akbar, a dog. You know, Muslimin, if there are dogs, what they do? Especially the sisters. Tell me. As soon as there's a dog, they are starting to run. Subhanallah. Sister, the dog did not yet chase you. No, that's a dog. Am I right? See, we heard a loud yes then. That is what Allah is telling you, that you see the sincerity levels of this man was absolutely plugged in. The reason is, it was a dog. There was nothing besides Allah that brought him in that direction. You follow? Subhanallah. So, develop your character towards animals, towards human beings. Build, don't destroy. Don't let anyone convince you that you need to destroy. You need to be destructive. You need to kill and harm in order to save yourself. No way. That is not prophetic. Like I said, it is not the method of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nor is it the method of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May He strengthen us. May He make us people with best character. We are suffering because of our own deeds. We are suffering because we have developed hatred within our hearts for one another. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once pointed out a companion who was heavenly. When the Sahaba radiallahu anhum inquired about what his deeds were, he did not have any extra deeds. He just used to do his farad. He used to do that which was compulsory and obligatory, but his heart was clean. He did not used to have hatred, ill feeling in his heart for others. That's what we need to understand. We cannot go around hating, because in that case, people will hate us and we will not like to live on earth. My brothers and sisters, look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Take a look at his life. Read about it. See his characteristics. Subhanallah. There was a Jewish man in Medina Munawwara who used to sell some food items, some grain. And the Prophet ﷺ, towards the end of his life, he needed some grain. And he gave his armor as collateral to get some grain in order for that payment to be made later and that collateral to be returned. And the Prophet ﷺ passed away with that armor, still with the Jewish man. Do you know that? That means he dealt. They were Jews and he dealt with them. Subhanallah. Why am I giving you this example? In order to clear the misconception that if a person is not a Muslim, you cannot talk to them, you cannot befriend them, you cannot. Some non-Muslims, they are more honest than the Muslims. Some non-Muslims are more upright, they are straight, they don't have sexual misconduct like some of the Muslims. Some of them are so upright because they have character, conduct. Learn that, subhanallah. Understand, your deen is very elevated only if you follow. That's why I'm saying today, we say we love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but what are we doing? Do we actually follow? The answer is no. No. We can all do better, myself included. I can do better. It doesn't mean that just because I am telling you things that suddenly I'm a prophet. Wallahi, no way. I need the mercy of Allah more than you. And this is why I always say, my brothers and sisters, if you are here today, you are here for the sake of Allah, to listen to a good message. Yes, you might have someone you like the way they present the message. Alhamdulillah, that's good. But remember, it's not that person that can take you to paradise. It is Allah and Allah alone. Remember that. This is why when people want to take photos, they say, Sheikh, can I take a photo with? I say, my brother, remember one thing. That photo will not help you in your grave. That photo cannot take you to Jannah. You cannot just show the angels, hey, you see, I was with this guy. Okay, come, let's go to Jannah. No, doesn't work like that, no. Even if you have no photos, even if you have never shaken this hand you don't even know what it has touched. May Allah forgive us. Even if you have never shaken this hand, your access to Jannah is nowhere near connected to the hand. It's connected to your relationship with Allah and the way you treat the rest of the people. And I want to end with a beautiful example. What is the example? Do you know the Prophet ﷺ was asked, O Messenger ﷺ, tell us, the people in paradise, what would have got them into paradise? Why will they be there? What are their characteristics? He said two things. Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi. Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi. He says, the consciousness of Allah. They worshipped Allah and they had good character with the creatures of Allah. Two things. You have huququllahi and you have huququl ibadi. You have the rights of Allah, that is your salah and your saum and your pillars of Islam and your acts of worship, that is with Allah. But you also have a relationship with the creatures that the same Allah has made. So when you go out here in Zamboanga and you see people, some of them will be dressed in this way and that way. Some of them will go to that church and this synagogue and this temple. Some of them will do this and do that. Some of them will be that way and drinking, and others will be this and that. You need to remind yourself, they are all creatures of the one I worship day and night. He made them. He created them for a reason. We forget that a lot of the times. He made them. You are special. Well, guess what? They were created by the same creator. And I keep repeating this because many people forget it. They were created by the same creator. Allah has greater control over them and us than we would have over anything, because Allah is the maker. Don't you believe Allah is in absolute control of everything? Yes, you do. Don't you? Yes, it's part of our iman. If that's the case, remember, Allah put them for a reason, to test you. Are you going to convey a good message? Or are you going to spew a message of hatred? What are you going to do? Convey a good message. Ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. Convey a good message. Many of us, we chase people away from Islam. How? Our character, our conduct, the way we operate, we cheat people, we deceive people, we are loud and aggressive. We have lots of hatred in us. We are racist, tribalist, in a way that is far from Islam. Subhanallah. It's happening in our communities. When the Prophet ﷺ says to someone who was trying to call Bilal ibn Rabah, this is a black man, a son of a black woman. And Nabi ﷺ says, you are a man filled with ignorance. Subhanallah. You have jahiliyyah in you. How can you ever say that this person is better or worse, or insult them based on their color, based on their race? Your race, your color, your tribe is a test from Allah to test you. Do you think you are better than others? I want to tell you one thing. Nearly every tribe on earth thinks that it is better than another tribe. Do you know that? Your tribe, whatever you belong to, maybe there are 20 tribes here. Each one thinks they are better than the other. Am I right? Thank you. Thank you. We have a problem. Our iman is weak. We are equal. That's what it is. We are equal. لا فضل لعربي على عجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا لأبيض على أسود إلا بالتقوى. There is no virtue for an Arab over a non-Arab. Same would apply for this tribe over that tribe, for this color over that color, or a white man over a black man, etc. Except through taqwa, piety. You are close to Allah, you are a better person. You are far from Allah, you are not a better person. So, getting into Jannah, two characteristics. A lot of people will be there simply because they had very good character. They were soft, they were calm, they were loving to the people, they helped for the sake of Allah. When I help you because I love Allah, and you were made by the one I love. I give you another dirty example. You see your boyfriend or girlfriend, astaghfirullah, it's happening today, and they're driving a nice car, and you know that's their car, and you see it parked by the supermarket. You get so happy. Why? The car belongs to my boyfriend. That's not even halal, by the way. But you are happy because, he must be in the shop. Let me wait here. Right? Because the car is there. The shoes are there. You follow my example. That example is low and very cheap. What about Allah? All these belong to Him, His creation. You should get excited. I helped you because you belong to Allah. I helped you for the sake of the one who made you and me. Subhanallah. That is a Muslim. That is the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to help those who harmed him. That's when they learned about Islam. He had the ability to destroy the whole of Ta'if. Do you know that? He didn't do that. He said, oh Allah, guide them. If they are not going to be guided, at least guide their children. What happened? After some time, the whole of Ta'if accepted Islam. But with us, I can imagine what we would do. Imagine if you were there, they just beat you up, they were just so, you know, you were bleeding, walking out, and the angels come to you and say, hey, just tell us, and you know what? We will destroy them, we will crush them between the mountains. We say, yeah, not only them, all of those people, break them up, destroy them, finish them up, destroy everything of theirs, because they harmed me. That's what we would say. That's why you and I, we are not prophets. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have not sent you in any other way than a means of mercy for the world. Not just for mankind, but for all the creatures of Allah. Mercy. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent as a mercy. So whenever you do something, ask yourself, what I am doing, is it merciful? If it is, you are following Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If it is not, you are following shaitan. May Allah make us merciful. Irhamu man fil ardi yarhamkum man fis sama. Clear hadith. Nobody can debate it. Allah says, have mercy upon those on earth. The one in the heavens shall have mercy upon you. Have you thought of what that means? Allah did not say, irhamu al-muslimin, yarhamukum Allah. No. Irhamu man fil ardi. Have mercy upon those on earth. Have mercy on the people. Don't destroy things. Don't kill. Don't harm. Don't maim. That's not Islam. Have mercy upon those on earth. And the one in the heavens will have mercy upon you. That is the message of Allah. That is the legacy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why Islam spreads where there is peace, where there is calm. Your nation grows where there is peace, where there is calm, where there is harmony, where you can practice the faith of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a beautiful way. It will only be possible where there is calm. Whatever destruction is happening is not in our favor. It is to our detriment. It's not to our favor. So my brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us as an ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us mercy, forgiveness, goodness. May Allah make us truly pious. Truly pious. The truly pious are those whose hearts are softened towards one another. Those who like to solve problems, not those who like to create problems. Those who like to build, not those who like to destroy. Those who like to serve, not those who want to be served. And the hadith I mentioned as a last hadith, I started it off by saying two qualities of Jannah. Taqwa Allahi wa husnul khuluqi. Consciousness of Allah and good character. And the two qualities of the people of hellfire. What is it that will result in the people who enter hellfire having gotten there? He says, Al-famu wal-farju. Two things. Your tongue and your private parts. If you abuse those two, how can you end up in paradise? So don't abuse your tongue. Say good words. Start off today. When you go home, before you go home, start saying good words to one another. Greet, smile, make people happy. You will become happy automatically. When you get home, you will build on that. So can we all make an intention, inshallah, that we will change ourselves for the good, inshallah? I heard that loud and clear, inshallah. And I think and I believe, every time I come to Zamboanga, I see the people are smiling a little bit more. I don't know, whether it is because now those railway tracks on the teeth are now out, you know. So we want to show the people our straight teeth. Because trust me, when I came to this country the first time, I was surprised that a lot of people had railway tracks. So I thought, what is it? Is it a trend? And everyone, even the old people, they are smiling. So much so that I thought there is something wrong with me. When I went home, I told the doctor, can I get those, So he told me, what's wrong? I said, no, I went to the Philippines. I saw so many people. Now I'm thinking maybe. He said, don't worry, your teeth are okay. I said, no, this one is skewed. That one. He said, it's normal to have a few skewed teeth. Subhanallah. It shows we are human. We are not flawless. We have flaws. We have errors. Your nose is bent. Your mouth is this way. Your beard is like this. Your face is this. No, no one notices it. Only you look at the mirror too much, you start noticing, Then you notice, what about here? And you keep noticing, just thank Allah. Oh Allah, you made me in the best way. And I thank you. So the moral of what I'm saying is, let's become better people. Let's all say we will contribute positively to our environment. And we will build by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We see you in Jannatul Firdaus. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for us not to meet in the dunya, we meet in Jannah. And if He's written for us to meet here, we will meet again and again. Not only in Zamboanga, but inshallah we will go further down to Basilan and Tawi, like I explained the last time. By the will of Allah. May Allah bless you all. Aqulu qawli hadha. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.